17 years old. My girlfriend moved to the big city of Bangor, Maine, which was several hours by car away from me, and it might as well have been on the moon were it not for my thumb. Even if I owned a car, I couldn't have afforded gas. So I would hitchhike to see her and spend a couple days and then hitchhike back. The adventures I had hitchhiking, I could probably tell stories all night about that, but one particular day, what happened was I had left in the morning with a little bag and a half a pack of cigarettes, and I got one ride to the on-ramp of the highway. And as I stood on the on-ramp of the highway, thumbing to get another ride to Bangor, this enormous black car, like an old 70s Cadillac, pulled up. The black was like spray paint, matte black. And the bucket seats up front were bigger than most living room recliners. They were enormous and leather. And there was so much trash on the car. And the guy driving was a very big man. He was much bigger than me, heavy set, with a big scraggly beard and long black, kind of greasy hair. I hopped in the car anyway, and and normally people say, "Hey, where are you going?" You know, all friendly. And he didn't say anything, so I volunteered, "Hey, I'm going to Bangor. How's it going? Thanks for the ride." He grunted. So we started driving, and I tried to make conversation a couple more times. But he responded with one word, or he grunted. He wasn't very excited about any of this. And so finally I gave up, and we were just riding along, kind of going fast, maybe 80 miles an hour or so. And I said, "Hey, you mind if I smoke?" The ashtray was full of cigarettes and other things. And he said, "Ugh." So I rolled down my window, and I went to light a cigarette, but his window was open, and my window was open, so there was a lot of breeze. So I had to cup the end of my cigarette and lift my elbows really high, like shoulder length, lifting my elbows up. And I was trying to light the cigarette with a Bic lighter. And very casually, he reached down between the bucket seats, and he pulled out an enormous Bowie knife, and he stuck it in me. Yeah. Yeah, it hit my rib. I don't know if he intended to hit my rib or if my arm's high, you know, he missed and he intended to stick it in me further, but he stuck it in me, and it hit my rib, and it hurt so bad. And so you need to understand, when my father was 12 years old, he tried to rescue a man who was drowning, and the man climbed on top of him and pulled him under and would have certainly killed him were it not for my grandfather, who swam out, knocked the man unconscious, and rescued both of them. My father from then on was adamant that no one should ever panic. He didn't blame the man, he blamed panic. And as we grew up, we had don't panic drills. You will not find these in Good Parenting Handbook. But by the time I was 17 years old, I was not allowed to panic. I don't think I'm capable of it. I really think that. So the knife was in me. Blood was pouring down my side. And I thought about my options. And I wanted to panic. And not panicking made me insanely angry. As anybody who has grown up in a toxically masculine culture can tell you, when you stuff feelings on that level, the result is rage. So I lit my cigarette, and then I took a drag, and my elbow was still very high because I couldn't put it down because the knife was sticking in my side. So I balled my fist, and I leaned into that knife, and I swung my fist straight across and backhanded him in the nose. Then things got crazy. I could feel the nose crunch. I knew I broke it. And he dropped the knife. And at the same time as he dropped the knife, he covered his face with both of his hands, his nose and his eyes. And he started screaming, "You broke my nose, you broke my nose." And he stepped on the gas. So we were screaming down the highway now and heading towards the dirt. And he's yelling, "You broke my nose, you broke my nose." And I'm like, you have to slow down. And he wasn't slowing down, so I grabbed the wheel and started steering the car as he was yelling, you broke my nose, you broke my nose. We passed a car. I didn't even think to wave at the guy. I was very concentrating on what I was doing now because I was still bleeding. We passed the car, and like a good driver, I got back in the right-hand lane. And he's yelling, you broke my nose. And I'm like, slow down. You broke my nose. Slow down. You broke my nose. Step on the brake. You broke my nose. You're going to kill us. Finally, he took his foot off the gas. And a short time after that, with coaching, he put his foot on the brake, and we started to slow down. When we, you know, got slow enough, I got out and just started walking and kind of left him there idling. And you'd think people would see a bleeding teenager on the highway, they would pick them up, but no. No, it's been my experience that the less you look like help, you need help, the more likely you are to get it. And the more you look like you need help, the less likely you are. So it took hours and hours. About an hour later, that guy passed me. And he slowed down and stuck up his middle finger at me, as if this shit was my fault. It's like, when you stab and rob people, sometimes it don't work out, buddy. Eventually, I did get a ride, and I got to my girlfriend's house very, very late. And she opened the door ready to yell at me and then saw all the blood. And so pulled me in and said, what happened? I got to explain. That's why I'm here tonight. Thank you.